It was the most lonely period of my entire life. After escaping the cult, the question remained, now where do I go? Hi, I'm Calvin. I escaped a cult.
Today I'll be spending a day with Calvin, an ex-cult member.
He's a fundamentalist Mormon having 5 parents and 44 brothers and sisters.
Oh yeah, and I have 44 siblings. Minor detail. New York City is one of the biggest surprises of my entire life. I used to milk a cow every morning. Living in a city sounded ridiculous. Today, for the very first time, I'm sharing my story of how I stepped away from the cult and made it to New York City.
First apartment in the city, baby! Let's go!
By the end of this whole thing, it's such a crazy story of how it all pieces together. This is turning into something a little bit different than I was expecting. I'm getting goosebumps just reliving this. Here's the craziest part of this entire story. Imagine leaving everything you've ever known, leaving everything behind, to start fresh in the great unknown. And the great unknown is New York City. Okay, if this is the first time that you're seeing me, hi, I'm Calvin. I grew up in a cult. I have 44 siblings. My grandfather was one of the main cult leaders with 5 other guys. He had 13 wives. My dad had 4 wives. And if you want to learn more about that story, the episode here, the Anthony Padilla episode, is probably the best synopsis of my journey. And I'll put that in the description below.
Quick pause here. Did you know that I speak at conferences and corporate events? It's true. If you are hosting an event and you need a speaker on mindset, resilience, or what it feels like to be a fish out of water, then I know a guy. And I might be a little bit biased, but based on previous reviews of other events I've gone to, this particular gentleman not only says things that are real and actionable that people can take away and feel motivated and make a difference in their lives, he's also not that boring. At least that's what I hear. Who's the guy? Well, of course, it's me, the guy with 44 siblings. So if you would like to see about me coming to speak at your event, then completely for free, you can request a speaking request kit at calvinwayman.com/speak. That's calvinwayman.com/speak. And who knows, together maybe we can make the best event in the entire world. So what do you have to lose? Doesn't cost anything to get the media kit. So let's see if it's a fit. Go to calvinwayman.com/speak.
This is a milestone episode for Cultured, episode 10. And already this has been quite the journey. The point of today's episode is there's content out there around what the cult was like, how I left the cult. There hasn't been a whole lot of deep dive on, okay, I left the cult, now what? Now what do I do, right? That's the point of today, is to give some context around that, because I left the cult coming up on 6 years now. Yeah, it's been 6 years. So officially, when I told everybody about it, it was the beginning of 2018. And I started doing interviews almost immediately within that first month. And then I stopped doing interviews because I was like, I don't know if I ever want to talk about this. And it actually wasn't until going on the Anthony Padilla show that I was like, okay, maybe there is something here. Maybe this is something I do want to talk about. And I'm glad that I did. But there's still a lot of questions on, okay, what happens when you decide to leave? Because all of a sudden you're out in the great unknown, but how did I go from living in the cult to being out of the cult? And how the f*** did I get here in New York City? And so I'm excited to share that journey on this episode. Before I dive into that as well, I just want to say thank you guys so much for watching, for listening, for subscribing. This has been, I have 2 camera angles today, like wah, wah, just in my studio apartment here. I'll be honest, this episode is for me. I want to bring people on along for the journey. But a big part of this podcast and this YouTube channel is having a place to express. And so there's one side of it is I want to express some parts of the journey so that it's there almost as a place of processing, of putting it out there. And then there is this other layer, this element to wanting to help somebody if it can. because I get a lot of messages and have conversations with people that have come across my content around leaving something hard. And sometimes, as impossible as leaving something hard is, that can sometimes feel like the easy part. It doesn't all of a sudden get easier when you're in that toxic relationship that wasn't good for you and you leave it. It doesn't all of a sudden just get easy. I know, because I talked to those people that say your journey of living in a cult and leaving a cult and the impossible decisions that it felt like when it came to leaving a cult feels a lot about my situation, even though I didn't actually grow up in a cult. There's a lot of crossovers there. And so I like to compare sometimes cultiness with toxic relationships in that sense. And so that's one of the other reasons I want to share. And I think a major reason that's important to do, yes, leaving was hard. And there's, again, stories that you can go find, or that story has been captured really well by Anthony Padilla and his team. What I want to capture more is just the journey after. Like what happened, the loneliness around it, perhaps the hope around it though too. Because one of the things that keeps people stuck is because it is such a giant leap into the unknown. Like, there is so much uncertainty. We know that whatever the situation is that we're in, I at least knew that's what it was. And there was no guarantees that the life that I was stepping into was going to be easier. And in many ways, it wasn't. It was way hard. But there's also some really cool parts to the journey and the story. And there's this self-discovery bit. And there's the part about being surprised by life when you actually lean into your own value set and authenticity. And so I want to share some of those stories here. And I think one thing that I would think would also be a fun way to begin this, and I'll embed this and you'll watch it with me, is I want to watch some videos that I recorded along this journey. It's sometimes fun, I'm glad I do this, that I have videos that I can reflect on and check out years later. And one of those that I'm going to play here is this video from late 2020. When I left the cult, I made that decision. I didn't know where I was going to go. I was still living near the headquarters of where it's based, near Colorado City, Arizona, in a place called Centennial Park. But I knew that I needed to go somewhere else, and I started to explore a little bit. I explored Austin, Texas. I thought of Los Angeles. I also thought of New York City. And I'll never forget, New York City is one of the biggest surprises of my entire life. Because I grew up on a farm. I milked a cow every morning. We had a garden. Like, I fed chickens and pigs and turkeys, and we planted corn and peppers and tomatoes and potatoes and carrots and all that sort of stuff. Like, I was living that life. And my dad was a construction worker, owned a construction company, and I was in construction. And so the idea of being in the city, like, everybody that I grew up around talked about having, you know, big trucks and a lot of property, not giving up vehicles and living in a high rise, living in a city. In fact, living in a city sounded ridiculous because we were always about, you know, being out away from the rest of society, being out away from the noise and the craziness of the world. And it'd be so cool to have 5 acres or 10 acres or 50 acres if you're really lucky and really get away from everyone. So there was really no exposure really close up to me that thought, oh, you know what? City life is the life. So in that context, I go to New York City for the first time. Now, when I went to New York City for the first time, which I think was around, it was the end of 2015, I was still in the cult, but I was on my entrepreneurial journey. I was starting an online business, and I came to New York City to go to a conference That was it. I just had this random memory that I want to share about my dad. There's some things about my dad that I want to share on the pod at some point. I don't think I'm ready yet. But I remember when I landed, I was 27, going to be turning 28. So I wasn't a boy. And when I get into New York City that first time, I had a missed call, several missed calls from my dad. And I call him back and he's like, yo. I was like, hey, you called? And he was like, I heard that you're going to New York. And I was like, yeah, I'm here. He's like, are you okay? And I was like, yeah, I'm fine. Why? Like, did you see, like, what am I missing? And he was like, are you okay? That's where the terrorists are. Yeah, that was funny. Okay. But here's the thing. I went to New York thinking I was going to hate it because it was so busy and bustling. I will never forget what it was like to take the train into the city for the first time. When I took the train into the city, something lit up in me. I'm getting goosebumps and chills just reliving this. Because when I did that, it was like, what is this? What is this? Like, of course I knew what New York was, but there was just something different in the energy of it all. But more than energy, this is what it felt like then and still. It felt like, you know, you ever try to put a puzzle together and there's like a piece left and it's just not working or something, and then all of a sudden you just twist it a little and it clicks into place. That's what it seemed like. It felt like that who I was as a person was operating on that wavelength. And I was like, oh my God, this is like, I love this. I had never felt more at home in my body. I just felt like I was in my energetic match. And again, that was super surprising. I had a great time that weekend. I ran around. I remember feeling parts of myself that felt like a kid, parts of myself that I don't remember being in. And maybe the last time I felt that way when I was 9 or 12. And I was still living in the cold at the time. That was just a feeling. I never forgot that though. So when I left the cult, it's now getting to this place where I'm like, okay, what am I going to do next? Where am I going to go? I thought of different places. And then I had this thought experiment with myself. And the thought experiment was, where would I go? Like, of all the places I want to go, because I knew that I didn't belong in Utah. I didn't belong in Arizona. I knew I was leaning towards a city like Los Angeles or New York City. And when I had that, the question I asked myself, which kind of seems strange, but it worked. I thought, which one scares me the most in a good way? Which one requires the most of me? Which one would put me in a position that I have to become the kind of person that I want to be anyway? And that was obviously New York City for me. I still love LA. I'm going to go to LA this weekend. I've already been there a few times this year. I love the beach and the obviously the weather. But when I think about the kind of person that I want to be and the grittiness that New York has a reputation for, I was like, I want that. And there's so many other pieces to it that I thought I would probably like, and I was right in terms of variety. But I'm going to pause on that. But that was the first time I actually was like, what if it actually is New York City? And I started to write things down as though this is it. Like, okay, I have not done this. I just searched in my journal. This is cool. This is live. This is happening right now. I have my journal in front of me. Here's something that I did in 2020. This is crazy. I'm getting goosebumps. I'm going to read this. You're going to start to get in a little bit of the inner workings of, because what I'm also hoping gives hope in this is some level of nugget or strategy for anybody that's looking to do something. Maybe it's not New York, but what's your New York? What's the thing you want to do? And I started journaling as though something like it had already happened. And this is just a simple journal entry. It's not big, but this is what I wrote at the end of 2020 before I had ever like, this was just right after I decided, oh, I would want to live in New York. And I was like, how can I start conditioning my brain that I am? And so my journal entry says this: I am a New Yorker. More specifically, I am a Manhattanite. I've made it here. I've dug my roots here. I love it here. I love the man that I am here. I couldn't be more proud of living here. I've worked hard to contribute to the city, and clearly the city has worked on me too. I made it here. I have a beautiful apartment with big windows looking down on the city. The rooftop looks amazing. Seriously, I love who I am and who I continue to grow into while living here in New York City. Ah, this is cool. I actually wasn't planning this for the episode, and we're going to dive into more of this. I'm searching more because these are just me writing ahead as though it had already happened. Here's another one. Ooh, this is cool. Okay. This is cool. Okay. This is, again, at the end of 2020, when I am still living in Colorado City, Centennial Park, trying to be like, what am I going to do? And this is what I wrote. I have lived a life. I'm living a life I want to live. I'm doing what I want to do. I'm making my mark. And I have a successful YouTube channel. Still working on that one. I'm living in New York City. I have an amazing group of friends. It feels rad. Ah, this is so cool. This is so crazy. I totally had forgotten I'd done this. It's so cool to look back. Here's another one. I'm living in New York City. I'm making my own creations. I have my videos, my books. I get to put my work out in the world, and it's appreciated. I like that. It makes me feel good. I love the man that I am. I love the man that I am becoming. I'm living in a New York City apartment on the east side of Manhattan. I didn't know I said that. I didn't know I said that. December 17, 2020. I'm on the east side of Manhattan. I'm in the Lower East Side. Well, technically East Village. I love it here because it's home. This is where I've chosen to place my roots, my brothers and sisters and fathers and mothers and aunts and uncles and grandpas and grandmas and best friends and acquaintances and new friends. And even the once in a blue moon foe, they're all here. Home, New York City, baby. My heart, my home, my return to home. Ah, this is so cool. Okay, this is turning into something a little bit different than I was expecting this episode to be, and I'm going to just follow my gut and go down to this. Me talking about home makes me think of another thing that I wrote around that time, around home, because when I left the cult, what I was really looking for is a sense of home. And here's a little article I wrote about home. Now, I'm going to piece all this together, and there's crazy magical shit, and I don't believe in magical shit. Like, I believe in magic, but in a real way, if that makes sense. Like, the way life actually is magical, not in a way that we have to force. Like, cool shit just happens, especially when you're, how can I use a word that's not so new agey? I was going to say in alignment, but what I really mean is you're following who you are. When you are saying, okay, this is who I am, this is what I want, and you're in that track, cool shit happens. And I'm saying that as someone that didn't have a lot of cool shit going on. And the more I've leaned into cool shit, and that is, I'm going to write that down because that's going to be one of the key takeaways at the end of this episode. I'll talk more about what I mean by leaning in. Cool shit happens. And here's something that I wrote titled, What is Home? Because that's really what this is all about. What is home? Where does home live? Many people have been lucky enough to have a place they call home. And yet, home is not the same place for everybody. Where is it? Home is where you come back to after your adventures. Home is where your people are, whether by blood or by choice. Home is where you feel the safest to be yourself. Home is where you feel like you belong. Some are lucky enough to have had that since birth. Some are still out there searching for it. And some have gone on a long, arduous journey and have finally found it. And if you always had a home, that's awesome. Embrace it. To those who are still looking, it's out there. You deserve to have it. And to those who just found it, fuck yeah. Welcome home. This is so freaking cool, because I wrote that just as I was contemplating home. I knew that that's what it was going to feel like. Now, that is just context, because then it's like, okay, cool, but how do you actually make it work? Like, when I started having these thoughts and feelings around how do I actually get here, what can I do? How do I do it? Like, has anybody heard of a thing called New York City rent? I was living in a small town on the border of Utah and Arizona. How do you think that rent compares to New York City rent? Let me give you the punchline. It don't compare. Like, my brain couldn't actually quite comprehend, except I had an advantage. What was the advantage? The advantage was I had already done something really hard. That was the advantage. The advantage was I knew that I had survived or had done something really difficult. I left everything and I was still standing. And so that knowledge made me realize, okay, if it is possible, well, it is possible, isn't it? Because even though I don't have the money, there are millions of people in New York City. And if there are millions of people in New York City and they're making it, then why can't I? And then I scared the heck out of myself being like, well, there's, of course, there's the self-doubt. And that's actually why I want to watch some of these videos. And it's just so crazy. So we're just going to walk through these pieces. And by the end of this whole thing, it's such a crazy story of how it all pieces together. And I think there are true nuggets in this, not just from a perspective of hope for somebody that's in a cult or a sticky situation, something that they feel like they can't get out of, but for anyone that is in something that they feel isolated or sticky or they don't feel like themselves, what I hope is that there's some glimmer that they're like, you know what, maybe I can. And that's the other reason why I want to do this long form, because everybody's special. I'll say that. Like, I was almost going to say, there is almost a little bit of self-deprecation, and I've actually been working on a lot of that and being like, there's something in the cult. There's like fake humility that I just don't like, where people would get up from the pulpit and be like, I'm such a bad person. I'm such a bad person. Like, God, I'm so lucky that God hasn't given up on me. And that's not what I'm wanting to say. But what I am saying is, I'm just a motherfucking human being, just like everybody else is a human being. But there are things that I did and decisions that I made that I think have helped this journey and can help others. I remember why I'm saying this. Once I made the decision that I wanted to live in New York, what I think is the next logical question that a lot of people ask and that I was asking is, well, how am I going to do that? But there's a thing that we do when we usually are asking, how can we do that? Sometimes our brain isn't going to know what the answer is. And so then it's easy that we get discouraged or we give up. And instead of me asking, can I do that? Or do I have enough money to do that? Or how can I do that? I had this strange question that I can't remember where I got it from, but maybe something in personal growth and development. And it was something along the ideas of, how can I improve my odds? Like, what can I do to just tip the scales a little bit in my favor from where I am now? And this was in 2020. So what was going on in 2020? There was a worldwide pandemic. So we're at the end of 2020, and I'm at my loneliest period, there's things I learned in that period too that I think I'm going to save for a different episode, because that was really fucking lonely. 99% of the people that I grew up with became estranged overnight. And I'm now living by myself in a town called St. George, Utah, living by myself for the first time. And I knew I wanted to go to New York, but I didn't have the money to, not to live, certainly. But this is what I did have. I was like, wait a minute. Could I go take a weekend trip to New York? And I said, I'm going to do that. And I just decided that. This is in December. And I was like, wait a minute. I've always wanted to be in New York for the ball drop. And it looks like it gets pretty crazy for regular years. So why not go during COVID when it's so empty? And it is so empty. I'm just going to watch this video, because this video, by the way, I have a big bushy beard back then. This is like nice and trim, but not back then. So I was going to see the Statue of Liberty, and I pulled out my phone. And one thing I did often, I'm so glad I did, is I've documented and journaled in my notes a lot in this journey. And this is me going to see the Statue of Liberty. I'm just going to watch this. It just gives a slice into where I'm at this point.
That's a tad better. Anyway, I've just been spending the last couple of days here in New York City. Reflecting on the year, reflecting on life, reflecting on the future. I don't know if you can reflect on the future, but that's what it feels like I'm doing. Getting centered, and
I just have to say, look how quiet it is. This is crazy. This is in New York City. In fact, I didn't realize how rare this is. I know it now that I live here and that I've taken the ferry several times. When you're on the ferry, it is packed with people. When I took the ferry to go see the Statue of Liberty, there were two people on that ferry, me and the captain and whoever was driving the boat. There might have been one other staff person. It was empty. I have video of me like on the boat. It's just empty. It's so wild. And then here's me out there, just quiet, wondering what the F I'm going to do with my life. Let's see.
Looking towards what's next. Anyway, I probably shouldn't hit record until I actually have something to say. I think I just wanted to capture this moment. These ducks or geese, whatever they are. It's right here. And just capture a moment in my life, looking for my place in this world, looking for what I want to do, who I want to share my work with, what kind of jobs I want to do, who I want to work for, and I don't mean that in a corporate sense, but what do I want to do, and who are the people I want to serve. That's who I work for. Anyway, I'm gonna wrap it up here and go look at the Statue of Liberty.
I love that. Why do I love that? Something that my closest friends know that I open up to is I want to be this brave person, and I want to do stuff that scares me, but I have a lot of doubt. I have a lot of self-doubt, and in moments like that one, and in other moments in my life, I think it's that self-doubt is something I hold a lot of shame in the moment. But seeing things like that, the shame's not there, because I'm looking at it from this new perspective, and I just feel so grateful for that version of myself making those small decisions. The small decisions of what? To say, yo, I am going to dare myself in a way to ask myself, where do I want to live? What type of person do I want to be? And the fact that I asked myself that question and then actually went there to fill it out and to do my thing, I think is freaking rad of that version of myself. It just makes me feel great. Now, just as an aside. So what I didn't know this at the time, but I was at Bryant Park. So I had a fantastic view, straight on view of the ball drop. My hotel was not too far, and I was on like a perch, and so I got to be like the unofficial countdown timer or something. Let's just watch a couple of these clips.
5 minutes, ladies and gentlemen! 5 minutes!
This is awesome!
Happy New Year! Happy New Year, New York City! Yes!
There it is.
Happy New Year!
That's cool. That's cool. Okay, so here's something I want to say at this part of the journey. Doing the things that I can do. So sometimes people get stuck on not knowing exactly how they're going to do a thing. I certainly do that. And the thing I love about what I did at the end of 2020 is even though I didn't have the money necessarily to like live in New York, I was like, I can go there. Now, this is what's cool. While I was in New York, I met a friend. Shout out to my friend Terry, who works on the Broadway show Wicked. She was the one friend that I hung out with when I was in New York, and she gave me amazing advice. And I told her my dream that I wanted to live in Manhattan. And she said, where in Manhattan? And I was like, I don't know. Isn't Manhattan Manhattan? She was like, oh, no. East Village is not the same as West Village is not the same as Midtown is not the same as Upper West, Lower West. They're very different. And so she was like, this is what I suggest. Try on different neighborhoods. That's the wording she used. Try on different neighborhoods. And so I tell you that because going into 2021, first of all, I didn't do much of anything. I just basically worked my face off and was like, okay, what am I going to do? And then I saved up some money. And then in 2020, I was doing an online business. I was doing client work. My main client that I had basically shut down his business. And so when he shut down his business, it shut down my business as well, at least the bulk of it. And I was in this place again where I was like, man, I was building towards making enough money or putting myself in a position that maybe I could live in New York. But now I didn't have an income. And here's the crazy part, though. I had that same thing go through my mind of like, okay, I don't have income to live in New York, but what do I have? What can I do? And what I decided to do is I was like, I remember Terry's advice, my friend Terry's advice. I'm going to go. Could I go take a trip to New York? And I did. This was in May of 2022. And I was like, I'm going to go take a trip to New York. I brought my girlfriend at the time. We broke up a short time after that. But I came to New York and I had such a good time. I stayed not far from where I live now in the Lower East Side, East Village area. But I came back and I went to Upper West, Midtown. Glad I went to Midtown because no offense, but anybody that lives in Midtown, I don't know how you do it. I don't know how you live in Midtown. I just don't. It's just, that's not for me. That's where all the people that are running around like they're, as the expression goes, I don't know if this is YouTube PC or whatever, but it feels like people are running around like chickens with their heads cut off. Now, if you don't know what that's like, I can tell you what it's like because I grew up on a farm and, you know, we harvested chickens as well. It don't look pretty and it's just a little bit crazy. So I did that and Terry, great advice. Here's the craziest part of this entire story. From my view, at least this is what I think is one of my favorite parts. I'm kind of standing up a little bit for this one because it just excites me so much how this happened. When I was coming to New York back and forth from Utah to New York in 2022 and trying different areas, living in different places, that was the first time in my life I really started to just lean in to the things that I thought were interesting. Even if there was no obvious gain, just something that I wanted to personally do. Something as simple as playing basketball. So I started playing basketball. In fact, there's a basketball court right out my window here. In fact, that's maybe a foreshadowing for how this story wraps up. But I start playing basketball and I started going to comedy. because I'm into comedy. I decide I want to do some open mics because I want to practice being a stand-up comedian, even if just as a hobby, just as a practice. I want to do that. And while I'm playing basketball, I meet this guy named Anthony. Anthony and I become fast friends. He lived close to the basketball court. And the cool thing is that he was also into comedy. And so we would go to some comedy shows here and there, and we would go to open mics, and we just had common interests. And he knew my dream of one day living in New York City. And again, I did not have any income when I was coming to New York City that year. And then very quickly, by the end of 2022, I completely ran out of money. And I was in New York when that happened. Now, where was I? Now, this is the crazy part. Where I was in my friend Anthony's apartment. So my friend Anthony told me that he was going to go to LA for a week or whatever. And he said, hey, you can stay in my apartment if you want. And so I stayed in my friend Anthony's apartment. This is still so funny to me. I don't know if I'm going to communicate what this felt like, because this is just so weird. But I stayed at my buddy Anthony's apartment the last trip to New York City in 2022. It was the trip where I ran completely out of money. I recorded a video in Anthony's apartment, depressed out of my mind. I'm just going to open this so you can see it. We don't even need to watch it. Like, this is me. You can, like, I'll probably put this in, like, if you're October 4th, if I'm just frustrated, I guess I'll play, like, a second of it. I was feeling like New York was kicking me out. I was like, can I actually make it here? Was this just a stupid dream? And in fact, this is probably a good part that we're going to watch this video. I actually made a video because I felt like New York was rejecting me in some way. So I was like, can I make it in Manhattan? That was the big question.
I grew up on a farm in a small town. Got some little piglets right there. This is where I grew up, right here on a farm. And I'm gonna see if I can go from this to making it in Manhattan. New York City, she is a dream for many people. They say if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. God damn, this is awesome. Central Park. I wanted to give it a shot, so I went to her before I was ready. I jumped right in. And after days and days, I still had it on my mind. How am I going to make this work? New York City is the perfect filter. You can't be here passively, I don't think. And that makes me nervous because I'm like, is she gonna filter me out? And then it hit me. I had this mix of feeling at home and feeling overwhelmed. Oh, shit! I started to doubt if I could actually pull this off.
This is so cool.
So cool.
City cry. It hits different.
New York City takes a certain kind of person. Am I cut out to make it here? Then I came up with an idea.
What a fucking great view to wake up to. Oh my gosh. I love this.
It's me. I'm feeling healthy today. I don't know why. I feel like I'm getting to myself. I'm gonna go shoot a YouTube video for New Yorkers, locals, get advice. Instead of just sitting around, the one thing I know is that there are other people that have either made it or they are making it work.
I just moved here and I'm...
Oh, I just moved here, but...
You did!
I said I moved here, but I didn't actually. I had just... But again, you see, it's like getting my brain to be like, yeah, I just moved here, kind of. I don't have a place yet, but I need advice for somebody that's new.
Looking apartments are
Me too.
Oh, okay.
So I'm just gonna go have a conversation with them.
First infield footage. I'm a little bit nervous. There's always a little bit of anxiety when it comes to approaching humans. There's gonna be inherent rejection involved, but I'm sure I'll meet some cool people too, and we shall see what happens.
He's a true New Yorker.
Yeah. How long have you been here?
Since birth.
How long have you lived in New York?
My whole life.
How long have you been in New York City?
Been in the city all my life.
How long have you been in New York?
40 years.
40 years. What is something you love about New York? What do you love about New York? What do you love about New York City?
The energy, baby.
The nice thing about the city is the energy.
A bunch of crazy people all living on top of each other, so it's normal.
Yeah.
The baddies. A lot of baddies, bad girls. Look at this walking by.
I love the diversity. Live in the East Village, so I'm not very far from Chinatown.
Close to you. I'm in Lower East Side. One of the things I love about New York City is overnight, cannabis became legal. Right out in the open. Welcome to the new New York. I come from a very small town, so that gotta be one of my favorite parts. People, cultures, food, perspectives. You were something else you were gonna say?
Yeah, the queer scene here, pretty good.
I'm straight, but I just got hit on the way here from a guy, and I was like, hey, I felt good.
Good.
Yeah, it helped my self-esteem a little bit.
You deserve that, yeah.
What do you love about it so far?
Coming from like a smaller place, there's definitely a lot more to do, a lot more to see. I love sitting in the park. I get to speak to a lot of very interesting people.
I want advice to a new transplant. What advice?
Explore. You just have to explore. Talk to people like you're doing. It's great. It can be what you want here.
Most people think like New Yorkers are mean.
I'm walking here.
They're just blunt. They'll still like point you directions for the subway. Take the A uptown.
Yeah.
You good?
But it's like not in a mean way.
That honestly is so healthy to my soul.
And you'll just see some random shit, but you'll also meet like some of the kindest people that just have such good energy.
How do you find your tribe?
Eventbrite and Meetup. Put yourself out there.
Yeah, go to do activities that put you in touch with other people.
Any tips? I'm super fresh in the apartment hunting game.
Getting an apartment in New York is so mentally and emotionally and physically exhausting.
Getting an apartment in New York City is so emotionally and physically and mentally exhausting. Or is it?
Why'd you even think you could do this?
And that's your optimism. I am a very optimistic person.
You have to make 40 times your rent. Get all your financial shit together.
I saw the listing saying, oh, immediate move-in, and I thought, okay, it's fine. Am I going to pay that much to live in a room where I have to get a full-size bed I don't fit because I'm too long? So just things like that are so overwhelming.
You're too long? What do you mean?
For a full bed, my feet will hang off most of the time.
How tall are you?
I'm 5'6" on a shorter day.
But they actually have beds that are shorter than your body?
Yes.
New York City's like a woman, and I'm like getting to know her. Feels like a relationship to me.
Oh,
like,
it is.
Yeah, yeah. I've been telling people, we've been seeing each other since May. I guess you could say it's getting serious. The city challenges you.
Oh, absolutely. When you think you got it, you don't. The city is gonna chew you up and spit you back out. You're gonna hate it, but it'll also get under your skin in the best way. It'll surprise you in many ways.
New York's a place where you can find a gold spray paint chair walking to the park.
It's true. Random shit all the time.
What else would you suggest?
Broadway theater.
I just went to my first Broadway show.
What'd you say?
Book of Mormon. It was very healing.
Yes, is that an extraordinary show?
It was so good.
If you get a chance, see Lion King. Extraordinary. It's going to take your breath away. Your inner child is going to just jump up and down.
That's why I'm here, baby.
I love this guy, by the way. This older guy gave me such good energy, good vibes, good advice. Oh, he's going to give me really good advice. Oh, just you wait for this.
Here in New York City for my inner child. That's why I'm here.
City, because here, unlike any other place I've ever been, I feel like myself.
How do I find my place in this city with millions of people?
It's all about the way you travel internally.
The way you travel internally. Ah.
I think it takes a certain kind of being comfortable with who you are. You are capable of handling whatever comes in front of you.
I don't know if I'm fully there, getting comfortable with who I am in my own skin.
You create your own reality. Now, the ramifications of that simple statement is like, it's an internal journey, not an external journey. Everything that you need to know about who you are is inside of you already. All you have to do is peel the onion.
What I love about New York City is this right here. What's your name?
Keoni.
A K?
With a K.
Awesome. Well, thank you. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thanks. Good luck. Good luck. Yeah.
I'm from a small town. If I'm being honest, I don't know if I can make it in Manhattan. But I do know that many other people are. All kinds of personalities, every age range. And if they can, why not me?
What's your name?
Calvin, like Calvin Klein.
Okay, Calvin. First of all, it's nice to meet you. I'm Jazzy.
Jazzy?
Yeah. What's your subscriber count right now?
First benchmark, 1K.
Okay, get him.
Okay. Oh my gosh, it's so cool to revisit that. Oh my gosh. Man, the only thing you need, sometimes, the most important thing you need when you're early in a journey is like little glimmers of hope. If like, is this possible? Am I crazy? Am I out of my mind? That sustained me like freaking crazy getting that advice from different people. Man, I love that. But I was still out of money. And it was like, again, I was depressed in that video. Let's put that video back up on the screen. I went back to Utah being like, I have no fucking idea when I'm going to ever make it back to New York. Here's something that's crazy. When I was going to different parts of the city, I would put wherever I was staying in Manhattan, I would set my maps to home so that if I was, I don't know, traveling out to a different borough, it got late. I didn't have to think about whatever address I was staying at. I just had to hit home and I knew what train to take to get me back home. And my last place that I had, well, when I went back home to Utah, when I went back home in quotes to Utah, when I left Utah, I did not change that default setting. In purpose did not change it. I kept it as home so that in my brain, I got used to the idea that New York City was my home. And I left it in there. So if I was driving somewhere in Utah and I hit home on my phone, I would look at my phone and it would show me, show the route crossing the country, saying this is home. I got to work, started getting clients to figure out a way to make some money, and then the craziest thing happened. Early 2023. My friend Anthony, we had stayed in touch. We would do phone calls, FaceTimes, and Anthony had this crazy idea. He said he was getting sick of his corporate job and he was going to go on a 3-month sabbatical. And he was like, you should probably start trying to apply for apartments. And I was like, I'm not ready. I'm barely making enough money. Like, besides, I didn't have any income for all of 2022. So it's probably like the previous year. So it's probably going to take a while for me to get to the place where I can actually qualify for an apartment. And he said, well, at least to get used to the process, you should apply. He said, say what? I'm going on the sabbatical. You should apply for my apartment. Obviously, you're probably not going to get it because my apartment's pretty expensive. It's in the Lower East Side, East Village. And you didn't have any income last year. But at the very least, that can be the first one where I'll put in a good word and you actually get the practice of, because I, again, like this person said in this video, my other friend said, finding an apartment is fucking painful, long, drawn out process. You have to give up an arm and a leg. There's a lot of money that you, like, there's this thing called a broker fee that, or something that you get, like, somebody just to get you an apartment. Here's the crazy part. I took my friend Anthony's advice. I applied for his apartment, and I got it. I was accepted. And what was Anthony's apartment? Remember this video. I'm going to look at it right here. Look at this video. If you're the editor looking at this, look at this video. Do you notice that brick in the background? What brick is that? It's this brick. Let me tie all this together. This is the same place that I had set to home for months before it was actually my home. Not just New York City, the very apartment that I had set to home in my phone is where I ended up moving to when I went from Utah to New York. And I didn't even have an income the year before. And so I told them that when I was applying, I said, hey, they're like, you're probably going to need to have somebody else apply that had income last year. And I was like, actually, no, that's not going to happen. I didn't know who the hell I could do that with. And I was just like, oh, I just took a sabbatical. And they were like, well, I was like, can I skip and do the next year? So they let me do the previous year. And the previous year actually was enough. But here's the other loophole. I hope they don't kick me out of my apartment for this. But here was one of the loopholes. One of the loopholes is I did make good money, but I also had people working for me. And so there wasn't a lot left over, but it looked like there was enough. And I was just making money in 2023 to actually afford the rent in New York. And so all these things just came together at once. And moving to New York, getting the apartment to New York, one of the biggest goals of my life, strangely, was one of the most smooth, easiest things that has ever happened. And it's so cool to reflect on, because at the beginning of the journey, you don't know how it's going to happen. And that's kind of what I just wanted to loop on for anybody that's watching this, because I was like, well, what did I do? There were pieces to this where I was unattached, and I think that helped. I knew where I wanted to go, but I wanted to go to New York because it was authentic to me. And if it took forever, it was worth the journey, because it's fighting to be yourself is worth it. I didn't care how long it was going to take. So there was that element of not being attached, and there's something in that. But here's the other thing. I leaned in. I didn't say I can't afford it and then just gave up. I just said, well, what can I do? What can I do? A part of the story I forgot to mention is when I first was saying, I think I want to live in New York, you saw that I journaled about it as though it already happened. That was just to train my brain that this is normal. You want to know what I would also do? I would watch YouTube videos like Life of a New Yorker just to make it feel normal. And who was one of the people's videos that popped up a lot? This guy, Brett Conti. Brett Conti has been on this podcast. This very podcast, episode 7, just a few episodes ago. I've gotten really lucky. Like, I almost feel like it's a lot even just saying it out loud, because I've gotten so lucky with it. I'm just so fucking grateful the way that it all pieced together. But I really believe there is a principle or something in this, that it's not about how to actually completely pull it off and do it. It's about what can you do to lean in? What can you do to improve the odds even just a little? And part of this too is leaning into my authenticity, doing the things that I'm into. It was because I was following that led me to come check out New York. It's what led me to meet Terry to give me the advice to check out different places and make me realize, by the way, when she did that, it's what made me come to the Lower East Side East Village. And I was like, this is where I want to live. I want to live here. And it's what made me like go play basketball and imagine myself playing basketball as like a regular thing. It's what made me run into Anthony. and Anthony being the person that decided to go on a sabbatical and applying for his apartment, and then it all just ties together because I was leaning in to things I could do, leaning into my authenticity, leaning into the things that I wanted to do, leaning into my own values, and then it pieces together. And so I'm going to wrap this episode with that. It's been a year now. I've been in here for just over a year and a half, doing my thing, building my family. I still have a lot of family back from where I come from, Utah, Arizona. There's this newer chapter happening, though, where I have friends and family that are of a different sort. I mean, it's just different. People that it's on a different level, I feel safer around emotionally, mentally. They challenge me as well. Shout out James, one of my really good friends here that just really smart. And we like talking about philosophy and stuff like that. And he keeps me on the straight and narrow with my logic. And yeah, there's so many things. I'm not even getting into the beautiful parts of New York yet. The nuance, the culture, the experiences. It's everything that I've always needed. I still have a lot of growth to do to keep it sustainable. This is one piece of it. And honestly, there's even parts of New York that I feel like I'm getting to have from my childhood. I grew up with 44 siblings. I'm used to being around a lot of people. New York, to me, is the best of both worlds. I get to have the autonomy of my life. I get to have my own space here in my studio apartment and podcast studio. And then I can also go hang out with other people. And there's just something so cool about that. And I want to continue sharing this journey. Again, this is a longer episode of just me sharing the journey to get here. And there's cool things that just happen all the time. I just bumped into Adam Sandler again the other day. It's just so weird. I'm getting to practice things that I want to practice, do things that I want to do. And I'm going to keep on going. So if you've made it this far, I just want to say sincerely, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for listening, for watching. If you wouldn't mind, if you'd like to support the show, I want to keep doing this. I want to do more of this. I want to share not just my life journey. I want to go have experiences in New York City. I'm also going to, New York City is my home base. That's the point of this. It's like a returning home. This is where I live. I still want to travel. I do a lot of traveling now, actually. And I want to be able to take the podcast on the road. And so supporting my podcast is simple as subscribing. So if you could subscribe or like or comment, then it would mean the world to me. So I just want to say thank you again so much. This is a pleasure to get to share a part of my journey. I hope there's something in here that maybe will be a kernel or a little spark to not give up. Everybody deserves to have a home, even if nobody else gets it. When I made that decision, nobody else that I knew did. It didn't make sense to anybody, but that's okay because it made sense to me. And that's all that mattered. Big plans for the podcast. This is just episode 10. I'm going to share a quick goal right here at the end. My goal is I want to be able to go full time in this thing, full time with YouTube and podcasting by episode 100. So you can help by subscribing, sharing. I don't know if I have a Patreon at this point or anything else. Probably not. But thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you on the next episode. Peace.
Okay. I mean, I'm just going to be transparent. We're like tripping right now. Anthony's not going to admit it because he's on camera. We're going to Washington Square Park. We can cross right here. Anyway, just so you know, I didn't make it all up. It's this guy's apartment. How crazy. Playing basketball my entire everything. Like, you're the puzzle piece that if Anthony doesn't exist, it's like this whole house of cards comes tumbling down.
Where are you walking to?
We're going to Mount at Washington Square Park. For real though? No, like, I'm so grateful for you, man. He's not grateful for me because I stole his apartment. He's like,
no, it's yours now. I gave it up. I was like, my time in here is over.
Okay.
And now your time. It's your time in here.
It's my time to shine.
That's yours now.
Cool. By the way, we need a rock climb.
Yes. You gotta come up.
Okay.